Until recently, the Juvex sector had only had 3 starfighters to perform missions and guard their base, and they were all Y-wings. Doubly, the commander, had left, leaving only 2 stunt pilots. These were Jake Fabri, who had an R5 unit and an ion cannon, and Uwono Wurjua, who had an R2 unit and a blaster turret. The Juvex Rebel base had proven itself over the past several months, catching the attention of Alliance High Command, who sent them 2 X-wings. Their pilots were Tessa Wayfella, with an R7 unit and Fletcher torpedoes, and Van Swiftlight, with an R3 unit, a hull upgrade, and a name that destined him to be a pilot. Clownman kept the squadron together rather than splitting them up on separate missions. He felt that the supplies they were bringing in from House Kellerman were the largest priority, especially since they would be the last supplies they would get from them, and they would need help getting those supplies out of their systems, which were being mined by their rival House Casito and the Empire. As a game note, this is a mini-campaign from X-Wing called Heroes of the Aturi Cluster, altered to fit the grand campaign of the Juvex sector. The story is beginning with the minefield story arc where the Rebel pilots are trying to get the supplies through the minefield. In the first encounter, entitled Tread Softly, they are clearing the mines themselves. The Rebel ships arrive to do their jobs with the Y-Wings on the left and the X-Wings on the right. As they approach the mines, they spotted Imperial mine layers in front of them, and the mine layer escorts on the right. Captain Fabri, having the highest seniority, ordered the X-Wings to go after the mines on the right and engage the TIE fighters, while the Y-Wings take out the mines on the left and take on the bombers. They did, clearing a host of mines right away. The X-Wings engaged the TIEs while the Y-Wings went steadily at the mines. The TIE fighters flew in close, but the X-Wings slowed enough to keep them in their front, and at point-blank range, they took out 2 of them. One of the bombers tagged Captain Fabri directly in the face, taking down his shields. The ships crossed each other, and Fabri got in a flanking shot on one of the bombers, stunning the pilot. All the rest of them cleared more of the mines. One of the bombers got behind Tessa Wefella and shot a missile up her rear, destroying her shields. One of the TIEs finished circling around and rushed up behind as well. "I'm in trouble," Wefella shouted. "Form up on me. I'll cover you," Swiftlight said. "No need," Fabri said. "We've cleared enough mines. Let's get out of here." All 4 pilots had coordinates punched in and waiting on their nav computers, so they shot into hyperspace. A first job well done. Back at the base, they had a chance to regroup. Game-wise, they could improve their abilities or gain more equipment. Jake Fabri raised his pilot skill. Uwono Wurjua took advanced proton torpedoes and extra munitions. Tessa Wefella raised her pilot skill, and Van Swiftlight took a shield upgrade and reinforced frontal shields. Their next mission would be to escort the supply ship through the remainder of the minefield. The Rebels arrived with the X-Wings in front and the Y-Wings behind. They found that the supply ship was already halfway through the corridor, and the TIEs, already alerted to their presence, were almost on top of it. The X-Wings went after the interceptors on the left, first blowing up the mines in front of them. The TIE fighters made an attack run on the supply ship, but the shields held. Tessa and Van ganged up on one of the interceptors, while all of the TIEs ganged up on the transport, decimating its shields and damaging the ship. But this was only the first round. Now the bombers arrived, flying up the rear ready to finish the transport off. All the Rebels turned toward them except Van, who got on the tail of the only interceptor that was still on the transport. They fired, but did not destroy their targets. The Imperials fired, one of them hitting with an ion pulse missile. It halted the transport in place, keeping it from getting through the minefield. The Y-Wing stayed on the bombers, but they all concentrated their fire on the fighters, which were coming around for another pass. 2 of them were destroyed, and the others were damaged. They had caught the attention of the fighters, who fired back at them. One of the interceptors fired an incredible long-range shot through the mines to manage to hit Tessa and take down her shields. It then swooped down behind her and got directly on her tail, ready to finish her off. But Van got behind him and blew him up just as Tessa took out the other fighter. "Heads up," Uwono said. "Decimator inbound at 190. Swiftlight learned of its presence as he came out of the explosion of the interceptor to be met with 2 large pulses that took out his shields and damaged the cockpit. With the bomber seeming to leave the area, all the Rebels now concentrated on the decimator. As Jake turned around, he hit a mine, causing a weapons failure. Uwono and Van poured their fire into the decimator at point-blank range, taking down its shields and blinding the pilot and damaging their weapon. Despite the damage, the ship drifted up behind the transport, its TIE fighter guiding in front of it. They were ready to destroy the supplies the Rebels so desperately needed. The Rebels threw in everything they had. But it wasn't enough. Both Imperial ships remained. The fighter shot at Uwono and the decimator at the transport. But both just survived, and they passed by. 3 of the Rebels remained on the decimator. Uwono fired her advanced proton torpedoes and blew it up! Jake couldn't hit the nimble fighter, which fired back at him and riddled him with hits. Jake tumbled to the side, and the TIE flew past, right in front of Van. But just then, the transport took off into hyperspace, so the Rebel pilots, not wanting to take another chance at missing the dodgy little fighter, flew past and into hyperspace as well. It had been a close call for several of them, a wake-up call for how dangerous this mission was. They recharged their shields, and the droids did what they could to repair the ships while in hyperspace. They would be needing to come out of hyperspace to navigate through a large asteroid field along the way, and who knew what they would encounter as they went. Sure enough, as soon as they came out of hyperspace, they spotted a TIE swarm. They would need to both clear the way for the transport and deal with all the TIEs. They got to work, clearing the first few rocks while the TIEs came at them. Jake and Tessa cleared the way for the transport on the left while Oana and Van shot at the nearest fighter. The TIEs shot back at long range. Then, in the distance, elite TIE bombers arrived armed with proton torpedoes and ready to fire. Oana and Van shot straight into the fighters on the right while Jake and Tessa remained close to the transport. They managed to blow three of them up in the center, creating a giant gap. The TIEs returned fire, doing minimal damage. Tessa turned around and took out one of the fighters getting close to the transport. Van turned left to help Jake hit one of the bombers, and Oana blasted the command vessel with advanced proton torpedoes, hitting the cockpit, shaking up the pilot, and damaging the engine. But two TIE fighters got on their tail, and they joined the bomber in hitting her with everything they had. It tore through her shields and ripped up her ship. Before she could get out of there, she had blown apart. The others had no time to mourn. One of the interceptors had slipped through and was attacking the transport. Tessa chased after it. The interceptor used its booster to get away, but Tessa's R7 unit gave her the boost that kept her right on its tail and locked her on target. She fired, blowing it up. Jake, now the only remaining of the original Y-Wing stunt pilots, narrowed in on the bomber leader and finished the job his partner had started. One bomber slipped through and fired its load, but the transport managed to dodge it, only to run into an asteroid right after. Jake thrusted after the fighters that had killed his friend, but they were more maneuverable, and he wound up in front of them. They took down his shield and caused a fire. The rest of them distracted the fighters while the transport pushed through. Jake and Van took on the bomber while Tessa took on another fighter, both of them blowing up. One remaining TIE flew out from behind an asteroid and took a parting shot at the transport, but Tessa distracted him, and he missed. She turned around, and Van came up to help. Together, they took out the fighter. With the way clear, the transport maneuvered to the other side of the asteroid field, and they were able to jump back into hyperspace, short one pilot. It was a somber event, memorializing one of their own, and the Rebel Cell could ill afford to lose fighter craft and its pilot. But it happened just as they got a replacement. Rebel Alliance HQ had sent them a pilot in their latest design, an A-Wing. His name was Jethro Vallon, and he was a risk-taker stunt pilot like the original three. He would fit right in, but Jake was in no mood for heroics. He wanted to get on to the next mission. However, first they would resupply and gain abilities. Van improved his piloting skill. Tessa got an engine upgrade. Jake took proton torpedoes. Once they were ready, they were briefed on the mission. Doubly had returned from Hoth with information stolen from the old Alliance base, which had been converted into an Imperial one. One of the more intriguing pieces of information had to do with something called Operation Phantom. It was a secret construction project on the edge of the Tyloon system, where wisps of Thole Shroud Nebula still drifted, a perfect place to hide something they didn't want seen, even though the system was not controlled by the Empire. They would have with them a Lancer craft they had recently acquired flown by their transport pilot, Inrot's plane. The Lancer would be able to more effectively scan the gas clouds for signs of anything they may be looking for, and could provide support fire against any enemies who might be guarding the secret. The pilots jumped into the area. Clouds of nebula dust drifted before them, but nothing else that appeared Imperial. On longer range scan, though, they could see two wings of TIE fighters closing in fast. Jake Fabri was still in command. He ordered Jethro to hop forward and check the further clouds while Inrot scanned the closer ones. He and the two X-Wings would intercept the enemy fighters. Everyone acknowledged, and they headed forward. Only three TIEs went after the X and Y wings, and Jethro and Inrot's found themselves faced with three regardless. Curiously, Inrot's came upon a small vessel in the nebula. It signaled him, and when he slowed for it, a winged creature emerged into the vacuum of space and flew over to his hatch. He led it inside, or at least into the airlock, and called Jake.
I found something I believe is important. I should take it back to headquarters.
Roger,
Jake responded.
Jethro.
Already past the ties, Jethro reported.
I'll recon the rest of the clouds.
Since the X and Y wings hadn't come upon all the ties, they were able to more comfortably take on the three in front of them. Jake and Van took out the one in front, and Tessa took on the other two. The three Aninrots got through the shields, which started a console fire.
I'll need some cover while I get out, he said.
On it, Jake said.
He got turned around, and Van headed toward the ties on the Lancer. They managed to distract the ties, but Tessa was left alone, and the two ties on her managed to take down her shield. Then another, smaller vessel appeared out of the swirling clouds. It bore sharp wings which pointed at her as though prepared to stab her. She tried to dodge, but it seemed to know exactly where she was going, and it hit, damaging her ship. The other ties bore in on her, and she tried to weave and juke, but she could see it was no use. She hit the ejection button just as the mysterious vessel fired. It blew up her ship, but she was already out, flying her jet chair as quickly as she could toward the Lancer. The others covered her and Inrots, destroying another fighter. The fighters had the remaining X and Y fighters sandwiched and fired on them. Inrots asked if they needed help.
Is Tessa on board? Jake asked.
Just boarded, she said. There's a winged beast in here with me.
I just found the evidence we're looking for, Jethro said.
Then get out of here, Captain Plane, Jake ordered.
Jethro, report when you've got that container.
The Lancer skipped out, and Jethro slowed to pick up the container. Jake and Van covered them.
Then the mysterious vessel appeared once again, seemingly out of nowhere.
Jethro had just pulled the container to him, and he hit the thrusters. The Phantom Fighter fired, damaging his shields. But he had what he wanted, and Jethro hurried away, the boosters on his A-Wing carrying him rapidly. He spotted a TIE Fighter in front of him and fired, getting a critical hit and destroying it on his way out. Van disengaged, and Jake covered him as he went, taking hits past his shield that nearly tore his ship apart. But they all hit it into hyperdrive and shot away from the gas cloud.
They had once again lost a ship, but this time it wasn't a pilot.
It was once again perfect timing, because Alliance Command had sent them their latest vessel, but they had no pilot to operate it. Few knew how to, even fewer dared to try. It was called the B-Wing, and it was supposed to be a more maneuverable and well-equipped bomber. Tessa would have to learn it as she went. Back at the base, they were all able to upgrade. Since Jake was the last remaining stunt pilot, he improved his barrel roll ability. He also became a daredevil and got expert handling.
Jethro took Push the Limit and got auto thrusters.
Tess got an auto blaster installed and got marksmanship. And Van took Elusive and raised his pilot skill to 4, the highest in the squadron. At mission briefing, they learned that the fighter they had encountered was the favored ship of none other than Rixar Traun, the scientist turned self-proclaimed Sith Lord who was trying to build his own legion of evil force wielders. It seemed that he was also building a squadron of cloaked fighter craft as well. They were building these ships in the Tyloon system, and the alien they had saved in the Nebula Cloud could point them to the base where they were being constructed. But they would need to decode what it was saying. In the meantime, they may be able to take out its leader while he was vulnerable. Rixar Traun was most powerful in person. But in a ship, they only needed to destroy the vessel to kill the man. So they came up with a plan to root him out. Rixar was hunting for people who were sensitive with the Force. So the rebels sent an uncoded message to the primary port station and the PLD station as though they were calling from a standard transport claiming that they were carrying some passengers who had unusual powers. They said this as though they would be transferring these passengers to another transport when they arrived. The rebels did this because they knew from a previous mission that the Imperials had a hidden presence within that station, and the word would get to Rixar wherever he was. The rebel pilots came out of hyperspace on the far side of an asteroid field. They wanted to get the lay of the area first in case any capital ships were about. There weren't, but TIE fighters were at the ready, flying in behind and to their flank. Regrettably, Rixar wasn't with them. Yet. Jethro and Tessa had just turned to face them when the battle commenced. Tessa flew straight into the swarm while Jethro flipped around behind them. Jake and Van went after the ones on the left. Each of the groups took on one of their targets. As they swung around for another pass, another ship approached out of hyperspace. It was an Imperial shuttle, and it closed in on the transport. It was an expected development, but they had thought Rixar would get there first. Regardless, they all tried to turn toward the shuttle, but the angles of their trajectories were off, and no one could get a clean shot on it as they bore down on the transport.
Get out of here, Inrots! He didn't take the bait!
I
wouldn't be so sure, Enroth responded, looking out the front.
There was Rixar's Phantom Fighter, peering out of its cloak, and coming right for them. Now they all had to reassess the situation. Keep the shuttle from taking the transport, destroy the mass of fighters, or take down Rixar. Jake was already bearing down on the self-proclaimed Sith Lord, and Jethro and Tessera were coming his way. So he told them to help him sandwich Rixar between all of them. Van, meanwhile, was on the rear of the transport, and three more TIEs arrived in front of him. The other TIEs fired at the transport, taking down its shields and ionizing it to a stop. Jake chased Rixar into his trap. Tessa seemed to pass by, but twisted around quite suddenly, and Jethro leaped forward from a seemingly far position. But Rixar's ship seemed to jump. They could all have sworn it was still ahead of Jake, but it was Rixar's power of illusion. His dark powers growing, and he showed up behind the B-Wing. He fired, taking out almost all of her shields. The others tried to fire back at him, but it was hard to get a bearing. The shuttle now pulled up next to the transport and began to hook on. Inroth could do nothing against them. They were prepared to take on a team of Force users, so they'd be armed to the teeth. He just needed to get the hyperdrive working again, or surrender. Outside, Rixar had vanished and reappeared again, this time next to Jethro, firing into him point blank. The rest of the Rebel ships reunited on the side of the transport and took out two TIE fighters. But two of the TIEs got behind Van and took down his shields and damaged his hull. Inside the transport, Inroth was surprised to find all of his power came back on. Stranger still, the shuttle undocked.
I'm free, he reported.
Get out of there then, Jake shouted, and Inroth did as ordered. But once he was gone, a lot more room opened up for the TIEs from every direction to bear down on the fighters. Jake turned his head to find Rixar drifting up just behind him. He tore into his shields at point-blank range. All the Rebels now had him in their sights, and they opened fire. But it was as if they were firing at a blurred image. It seemed as though one or two shots got in, but it was impossible to know for certain. The other fighters, meanwhile, opened up on them, tearing through their shields and nearly destroying Van. Jake called it. They weren't likely to take down Rixar, and they were more likely to be taken down themselves. So they ramped up their hyperdrives and shot away. When they reestablished communication, Inroth explained his confusion at the sudden return of power at the same time the shuttle undocked. Tessa came up with the best guess. If Rixar had as much control of the Force as it seemed, he probably let you go to clear the battlefield so all his ships can concentrate on taking us out. If he figured out it was a trap, why didn't he leave? Jake asked. We weren't a threat to him, Van answered. At that point, he had trapped us. Well, I for one hope I don't run into him again, Jethro said, after having been completely outmaneuvered, which was something he was not used to.
They met with Eshka Erostren, who was in charge of the base while General Cloudman was out on his own mission. He told them that communication had been established with the alien that lived within the gas cloud.
It had told them that Imperials had set up a base within their home and was positioning their gas cloud within their fumes. It confirmed that what was being built at this base was more Phantom fighters. Like the one we fought, Jethro said with a shiver. And likely to be flown by some of his students who might be able to use his powers, Tessa said. We need to destroy it before they can do that, Van declared. Jake agreed and got the coordinates of the base. We need to destroy it as soon as we can. Inroth, get the Lancer. Everyone got to their ships. Jethro got autothrusters attached to his A-Wing. Tessa became a marksman, and Van became elusive. Everyone's pilot skill was now 3 except Van's, who had a skill of 4. They hyperspaced to the coordinates with Inroth in the middle, Van and Jake on his left, and Tessa and Jethro on his right. This was clearly where the base was. They spotted 3 of the Phantom fighters already. Whether any of them was Rixar, they did not know. Nor did they know where the base was, so they set about looking.
Okay, just as before. Inroth, you search near. Jethro, you search far. The rest of us, choose a Phantom and take it down.
As they went, they all kept their eyes peeled for signs of a base. The Phantoms came at them, though none seemed to have more skills or abilities than the others. Still, the Rebels stayed vigilant. Right in the center, Jethro spotted a landing platform, and a Phantom launched from it, well camouflaged within the cloud. It flew right up to Inroth as though it would ram him. But suddenly the image flashed around and it was up on top of the Lancer.
I think I found him, Inroth said.
He had gotten a glimpse of the pilot when he flew near the cockpit. He didn't know what Rixar looked like, but this fellow looked intimidating. So it probably was him. Van jousted with one of them, neither scoring a hit. Then Jake felt a strong jolt behind him. The command ship had gotten behind him and ripped up his shields.
Rixar, he cursed. It was still firing, smashing the hull of his ship. A little help, he shouted as he turned his ion cannon to fire back. But the ship kept skipping out of the way. Tessa turned to him and fired a long shot. Though it didn't do any damage, it did distract the pilot, and Jake was able to slip into the cloud on his left as the ship on his tail flew by. Van turned all the way around so he could help Jake, and just behind him, Inrots found the starbase. It was a manufacturing plant, all right, and it was armed with large cannons. All craft concentrate on that base. What about Rixar? Van asked. Priority is to cut the head off the snake, Jake said. Don't let it multiply, Jethro said, and he rushed in to help. Van and Jake were already tangled with the ships before them, and they fired, taking out one of the Phantoms and damaging Rixar. Tessa now had two on her, though her shields were holding steady, so she stayed focused on the prize. They got set up for their attack run, but then a new problem arose. Swarms of TIE fighters came from every direction. The Rebels would have one chance at this, and even then they may not survive the onslaught as they were targeting rather than dodging. But if these Phantoms got out with Force Wielders at their controls, they would be a greater danger to the galaxy as a whole. So they narrowed in on the station, all except Van, who flew into the swarms to try to hold them at bay. The enemy ships fired, damaging them all severely. Tessa's shields failed, and her stabilizer came loose. Van's ship was riddled with shots from every direction. Jake's ship rocked, coming only one hull point away from being destroyed. Then it was their turn. The Rebels fired off all of their ordnance, sparing nothing. It was a hit! The manufacturing facility exploded into a million pieces, and they flew through the blast, still in formation. That's it, let's head home, Jake said, and they pointed away from the battle area. They had come close, but they did not lose a pilot this time. Later on, when Inrots described the pilot he had seen, he would learn that it had not been Rixar. This was someone else. Though the manufacturing plant was destroyed, three of the Phantoms were still flying, and Rixars will still be around. That made four Phantoms still in the mix. Something to consider in time. But for now, they had a much bigger problem to deal with. They returned to base to find that more starfighters had come to join them, and they would be embarking on the most important mission of their lives. This video is one of four stories that all happen at the same time. Click on the top box to go to the juncture of all three other stories, and click on the bottom link to move on to the next video in the series when it's ready. Thank you for watching, and happy gaming, everybody!